And thanks to our partner, Bibelos, Lebanon. And this is our first, fourth Roppongi Dialogue. And the objective of this program is how do we define ethical family and how do we build global education on it for the protection of human rights of its members. And we are very lucky to have panel from across the world. One here, and one of our panelists, I won't say the names because I've let the moderator introduce everyone, from the US, Lebanon, India, from London, and in Tokyo. And we call everybody to join us so we can build a social movement around ethical family program. And we are looking to create two types of teams. One is editorial team, so we can build an academic dialogue on all the issues related to families. And secondly, advocacy team, which we could use visual arts, performing arts, technology, and just grassroots efforts to create people's engagement. And so we can have a global movement on ethical family. Mm-hmm. We all belong to a family. Mm-hmm. And with this, I hand it over to our moderator, Ms. Vivian Kang. Kenny? Oh, sorry, I'm pronouncing your last name so incorrectly. She's a lecturer and artist in Lebanon. Vivian? She's on the Chris. Unmute Chris, UNESCO. Okay. Unmute both of the UNESCOs. Vivian? Kemi?
Yes, I'm here.
Yes, maybe you can introduce UNESCO.
Oh, sorry. Yes, I can. Hello, everyone from UNESCO headquarters. So my name is Kemi and I'm working for the MOST program who is supporting this initiative. And right now we're trying to build a big network, a big community around this Roppongi Dialogue project. So I'm very happy to be here and looking forward to the discussion.
And then now I give it to Vivian in Lebanon.
Hello, can you hear us, Sonia? Can
yes.
Everybody hear us?
Yes.
Oh, fine. Thank you. Hello?
Yes.
Yes,
yes. Okay. Well, I'd like to greet everyone. Hello from Lebanon, Sish UNESCO Biblos. Here with me, Dr. Darina Salima. We'd like to welcome you all. Hello to all the participants in Tokyo and our group of lovely panelists who joined us today Roppongi Dialogue on Family Audio-Needs Learning. As you know, that this Roppongi Dialogue is a monthly philosophy salon that is initiated by the Glenn Foundation, the Marty Foundation, in partnership with UNESCO. And they launched this amazing initiative on ethical family. Oh, why family? So family, as we know, is the first social institutions in our life. It is where we are born and where we die. Family is today facing many challenges in the world today, and the values of family have been also challenged. Therefore, the world and the international community needs to put family and protect family around the world. Now, discussing what is family, and they've looked at family from a sociological, religious, and legal perspective. But today, we are going to look at a different perspective. We're going to look at family from love. So love today, because love is the source of life, and it's the source of light and protection for the family, and not just the family, but it's the source of power for the whole world. So we will be looking at family from a philosophical, physical, and spiritual, as well as psychological perspective. The Greeks have dwelled on the understanding of what is love. Plato, for example, looked at love as the desire of beauty. He looked at it as an evolution from the physical to the soul kind of love. And also, Socrates looked at love more from a different perspective. He regarded it as more superficial love. Aristotle, on the other hand, he looked and concentrated on the superiority of loving over being loved. So whatever the categories and nature of love, whether it's eros, the erotic love, or agape, the divine love, or philia, the love that is about loyalty and appreciation that exists between family. So whatever this love is, wherever it is very crucial for not only the family, but for our society as a whole, and for the meaningfulness of life. So the context of love's context in the family plays a significant role in bringing family together, in protecting the family as a shield, and also in preserving the health and the continuation of the family. Whether it's care, commitment, and knowledge, these values are very crucial to be part of a family, and they transcend from the parents, which are pillars, all the way down to their children and then to their grandchildren. So we have around us a more of a cycle of, that is in cycle of love, and this cycle moves from a family to a society and more down towards building peaceful nations, building a happy and positive life. And therefore, by empowering family and love, by empowering them, we bring so much power to our life on this earth. And as the world goes into wars and more violence every day, love and family becomes very core. And while the world is thinking on different sustainable developments around the world, there is a need for empowering and protecting family and love. Therefore, why not have family as one of the main sustainable goals in the world today? Why not love be our highest priority, our highest sustainable goal to protecting family, love, and the society? So all the world needs today really is love. And before I move on to introducing our panelists today, I would like everybody to join us in a very simple activity. It's not a test. I will be, as an artist, I will be posting some pictures, some famous paintings, and I would like the participants to join us into...
Yeah, that's good.
Yes, can you kindly give us access to... Hello, can you give us access to send these images out to everyone? that you see in front of you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Are you able to see the image? Can everybody see the first image? Can everybody see the image? Oh, okay, this is not a test. So I just want to have the audience be involved with us here today. So looking at the first image, anybody would like to comment on what kind of love they think it is and what does it mean to them? Any volunteers? Can't hear anyone. Okay. Yeah, the first reply comes from here, from Dr. Saliba. She said this is erotic love. Yes, it is an erotic love piece by the famous Auguste Rodin, Eternal Idol. And it also carries more of a not only erotic love, but also passion, a lot of passion. And yes, thank you, you breathe sideways, definitely physical. Yes, you know, yeah, but I mean, some people might even regard it as love, passionate and true love. And if you see many women love this piece because we see the woman being, you know, on a higher position than the man. And there is this love and devotion, a lot of passion into it, yes. The second slide, can we have the second slide, please? How about the second painting? And what kind of love is this love in this portrayed in this painting? Can you unmute the speakers, please, so they can participate? Mrs. Sonia, can you unmute the participants so they can participate. Can you unmute them from here? Okay, I got a reply. People saying that online that it's a woman holding a baby, and somebody said it's very vague and it's very maternal. Actually, it is. It is maternal, and it is called the Maternité au miroir, which is a famous painting by the Lebanese artist called Gera Bosian. It portrays family love and maternal love. Yes. The third slide, please. Okay, I know everyone knows this painting. Can we have someone from the audience tell us what it is? Okay, thank you, Sachi Inori. Yes, it is a very romantic. Anyone else want to add anything on this beautiful piece by Gustav Klimt? It is, yes, thank you, Julia. Yes, it is unconditional love, absolutely. Yes, true. Anyone else? Okay, we're going to move to the last topic. Oh, somebody, Anne Marina said, yes, it's a protective kind of love. Yes, absolutely. The clinic painting has a lot of protection, and that is seen with the gold covering the couple. It's love protection, yes. Godly love you bring. Yes, the last one, yes. The painting we're seeing, the last one here, is a painting actually but called The Triumph of the Divine Love. And it is by Peter Paul Rubens. And yes, it is a celebration of the victory of, it is very spiritual. Yes, thank you, Diane Stewart. It is very spiritual. And yes, it is actually a celebration of the victory and the defeat of evil by the divine love. It's one of the really beautiful pieces on divine love, and I really love it. Anyway, I'd like to thank you all for your participation and contribution. And I want to move on to the panelists with us today. I had the pleasure of meeting our panelists, and I'm very pleased to introduce everyone. Okay, yes. Okay, everybody can see me now, all right. Okay, first I would like to introduce Dr. Yupreet Daliwa, MD, former director, professor of ophthalmology, University College of Medical Science, University of Delhi. Dr. Yupreet is a humanist and has deep passions for humanities and healthcare. She is a co-founder of the Health and Humanities Group and founding editor and researcher in Humanities Medical Education and online Health Humanities Journal. And I'm very impressed about knowing Dr. Yupreet is that she is also a writer, and she published a book on health-related poems titled Inverse Medicine, and she happens to be also a novelist and a romantic writer, and you'll be surprised why she's today here with us, but yes, she is a romantic novelist and under the name of Reet Singh, and she has received the National Annual Award for Medical Humanities. Thank you so much for being with us, Dr. Yupreet, and I'm very pleased to have the opportunity to have met you. Please, the floor is yours. Please go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Vivian. I'm delighted to be here. Thank you, Sonia, for thinking of me. Today, my role or goal is to convince everyone how important romantic love is in a relationship, and perhaps even get you all to define what romance means to you. So I'm going to start with a story. And this happened about 36 years ago when I was of a certain age, and my parents, you know, I come from India where 36 years ago you didn't date unless you had extremely liberal parents, and the elders found a potential spouse for you, and they said, why don't you go and see if you like him? And then we can take it further with his parents and talk and, you know, maybe make it happen. So they said that there's this friend who I knew many years ago, and she has a brother, and why don't you go and see him? So off I went with sister and friend in tow, and I set eyes on this dapper young man who was handsome and who spoke well, and he had a sense of humor, and he was intellectually, I thought he was really up there with the best in those 2 hours that we were allowed to talk to each other. So when we were going back after that first meeting, I was very much like Eliza Doolittle from My Fair Lady. And I was singing, I could have danced all night. I could have spread my wings. And my friend and my sister were staring at me. They said, you can't know so soon. I said, but I know this is the one. And of course we got married and 36 years later, we're still together. So I presume that, and you know, when anyone asks me, what was that? How did you feel when you first met him? How did you two get together? I always say it was love at first sight for me. We had an arranged marriage, but it was love at first sight for me. And when I was researching for today's talk for the panel, I realized that that was a complete untruth. Because you cannot fall in love with a person unless you know them slightly deeper than a first visit. And so this first visit, it wasn't really love at first sight, I now believe, as of yesterday. But it was, it was definitely physical attraction at first sight. And love came at second sight, if not third sight. But it came, and it's been wonderful. So what you need, really, normally this is the way it starts. When you meet someone for the first time, you could be physically attracted to them. And that's what leads you to want to meet them again and to get to know them better, perhaps see how they think at the next meeting, maybe see how they handle their feelings, and then maybe connect on an emotional level. But you need to connect on many more than just the physical level for it to transition, or for the physical attraction to transition into love. And so, you know, for example, you need to be fulfilled on many levels. And that's how you get your happy ever after. And that's how relationships develop through love. So then the next question, of course, was what about romance then? Is romance love? Is love romance? So then I Googled this again and I found, I believe that romance is magic, but that's not good enough to explain to anybody what romance really is. And I'll be asking this later. I'll want everyone's definitions of what they think romance is. But when I was Googling, I found that in many places, people were using these terms in either this or that. So they were using them interchangeably. It was romance and love were being equated. And I don't agree, because I agree that love is where you connect, where you like many things about a person and you want to be with them and you look forward to spending the rest of your life with them. You want to have babies with them, raise those children together, make family a family. That definitely is love. But then romance is the magic. It's a little thing that rides piggyback on the love. You can't have love, you can't have romance if there's no love. That's what I believe. So I wanted to find that one word which would help me to understand for myself and to explain how romance is different. And that word, I believe, is courtship. In very liberal societies, people are allowed to meet several times before they make up their minds whether they like each other enough, whether they love each other enough to want to spend the rest of their lives together. But in places like ours, where we have arranged marriages, and people are getting very, very liberal and open now. So lots of young people are finding love before marriage. But if not, the first few months or years of your married life are spent in courtship. But basically what happens is, during the courtship, there is both of you, actually, if you're both interested in each other, you are trying to convince the other that you are worth, bringing into their lives. You're trying to convince people, the person, that they are extremely, that they have high value in your eyes. and you'd like them in your life, you'd like to start a life together. That's courtship. So you're on your best behavior. You're doing everything you can to convince this person to take a chance on you. Now, if you get married, it's a big relief because now the courtship can end. By the, you know, courtship is very high stress because you're always on this, you're always tense, you know, will this work? Will this not work? Am I doing the right thing? Is this really the right person for me? And it has ups, it has downs. So obviously the day you get married, you say, okay, now I've achieved what I set out to, goal achieved. Now I can let down my guard a little bit. Now I can be less than perfect. And it's only correct and proper because you can't be on your best. You just can't. And especially in a married relationship where there's love, you feel safe. You feel like the other person has your interests in mind as much as they have their own interests. It's in their interest that you be happy. It's in your interest that they be happy. So you will busy yourself with the setting up this home, getting back to work, raising this family, getting the in-laws, connecting with in-laws, etc. And there may be much less time for each other in terms of romantic love. So if the courtship ends with marriage, then the magic ends. And it's a nice, it's a loving relationship, but it's sort of placid and there are no surprises. And it can go on like this forever. It's not really a problem. But imagine if you did continue the courtship even after marriage and you used as many opportunities as you could, not every day, every minute, because that's exhausting and it's impracticable. But if you used opportunities to show the other person how much you value them, it's not about talking. It's not about saying, I love you. I keep saying, I love you morning and evening. Isn't that enough? No, that's not enough. I think you have to show the person how much you value them and that you are worthy of their continued love. And that's just it. It doesn't have to be a big gesture, although I wouldn't mind if somebody bought me a villa in the south of France. But it doesn't have to be that big. It should be a tiny little thing. It could be, so I'll give you another story then. In the first few months of our marriage, I discovered that my husband was a realist, a pragmatist, and grounded. And I was this romantic person. And I thought, initially that I don't know how this is going to work out. But then it worked out beautifully because I think we needed this little difference to keep us together. But when our first anniversary approached, and I was in this town, miles away, trying to become an ophthalmologist. And he was here working as a teacher in a medical college, trying to make enough money so he could finance my studies. I became pragmatic and I said, you know what, we didn't have cell phones, so we wrote to and fro. And I said, yeah, I think we're going to have to celebrate our first anniversary apart because I have this academic commitment and that academic commitment and I can't come. So I was the pragmatic person in this instant. And my husband got onto a motorcycle and he drove those 5 or 6 or 7 hours so that he could be with me on our anniversary. He became the romantic. So however much he might say, I'm not romantic, I can't do those things, I don't believe it. And I feel that romance in a relationship is really in the eyes of the beholder. If you find something romantic, it's romantic. It doesn't matter if the other chap says, no, I'm just being sensible or I'm just being pragmatic. So the other thing that I want to talk about with respect to romance is that it is, as Vivian mentioned, I write romance. When I first won this contest for a romantic story from Mills and Boone, that's when I got a 2-book contract. And it was very exciting, but also I was this professor in a medical college and I was teaching young students and I was dean of the medical faculty. And you know, I remembered, I kept getting flashbacks of how if we were reading romantic novels in a public, say in a bus or in a train while going from point A to point B, we would often paper cover our books so that other people didn't know. But did we do this with P.G. Wodehouse? Did we do this with Agatha Christie? I don't think so. And then people would always be saying, no, no, don't read this literature because it is, it'll put ideas into girls' heads and this is not real life. And real life is not like that. It's a married life is really hard work. And, you know, they'll have expectations which will never be fulfilled. And that is so sad. But, you know, that was, it's so sad that romance, people don't expect their married lives to be romantic or to be there to be unconditional love in that relationship. And I'm talking about arranged marriages. So it can happen that you marry somebody you don't like very much, but whose families are very close to your family. And he's doing very well and he's earning big bucks, etc. But you don't like him. So that's sad. But the so what happened was when the publisher asked me whether I would go with my own name, I said no. I said no because of the stigma that had been internalized and which I thought people are going to say, oh my God, ma'am writes love stories. And they confuse romance with erotica, which it isn't, or with, you know, with pornography, which it isn't. So, which it really isn't. So, so I chose a pen name and now I feel really bad about that because it was all the conditioning that I'd had over the years and I wish I hadn't done it. But it's also sad that we don't take romance in our relationships for, we cannot take it for granted because many people think it's a frivolous thing not to be, you know, considered. When you think about it, romance and romantic love has health benefits. And I feel constrained to talk about it because I'm a physician. So it's not just for you, it's the individual, the partner, the children and the extended family. And so therefore even the community benefit if there's a loving romantic relationship at the head of the pyramid. So what happens is one, you take better care of yourself. You are happier. Your blood pressure is controlled when you feel cared for. Perhaps you take better notice of your partner's health so that if there's something going on there, you can urge them to get checkups faster. Also, you need fewer doctor visits. This is all from the medical literature. I'm not making this up. And imagine children growing up in a loving relationship where they see how the parents are growing independently yet codependently, how they are loving the other as well as themselves and the children. When children grow up in this kind of environment, they naturalize it. They realize that this is how it should be and hopefully they carry it forward and they become balanced young men and women and they perhaps will then pay it forward by creating ethical, happy families. So lots and lots of benefits to loving your partner and to bringing romance into the relationship. Thank you, Vivian and Sonia and everyone else. You'll have to unmute.
Thank you very much, Yumi, for this beautiful picture, many beautiful pictures that you have drawn for us today on family love and romance. And you are absolutely right. I mean, romance is a key point that it is lovely to be seen by young people as well within the family. I think when young people and children see that their parents and are in love and this gives them a lot of comfort and satisfaction and there's a lot of peace there. And I think also it empowers both partners. I thank you very much, Dr. Yumri, for this amazing, amazing. You're a true storyteller and you really took us into a lovely story of your life and all the beautiful. I really am looking forward to reading your novels. I didn't forget that. I thank you so much, and we move on to our next panelist. Also a wonderful and amazing person, Mr. Johnny Cassell. I would like to welcome Mr. Johnny Cassell. He's a relationship coach. He's a best-selling author and leading voice in the world of seduction, dating, and lifestyle development. He helps elite and professionals all around the world to get core confidence and to be able to attract their partners. So that's really amazing. Okay, and his coaching experience extends and exceeds 2,000 people, including CEOs of some of the world's largest companies, celebrities, as well as royalty, and over 100,000 coaching hours and 200 international workshops. And he's been featured in the GB News, Sky News, BBC Radio, and Sunday Times, and many other publications. I happen to have spoken with Mr. Johnny Cassell, and he's a very easy person to talk to. He's not only charming from the outside, but a very charming person that you enjoy, and what he's doing is just amazing. So the floor is yours, Mr. Johnny Cassell. Please go ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Vivian. And I just want to thank, first of all, Sonia for inviting me onto this opportunity. Never in a million years did I think that I'd be sat on a worldwide conference call with UNESCO with such a fantastic initiative. You know, my journey started off as a need for myself. I was hopeless at building relationships with people, even on a surface level. So that was the path that I chose. And as I got into it, I realized that this isn't just about meeting people based on attraction. You know, this is something that, this is people skills, right? When you learn how to speak to people, you develop confidence, you develop a certain power, you have the ability to build relationships, right? And that's something that I've been doing for over 15 years now. I've been helping people build relationships on many different levels, right? For romantic purposes, to build out their social circle, to improve the relationship they have with themselves, and also the relationships they have at home. Now, granted, a lot of my work has been more geared towards helping people find success in their romantic and their social life. The family aspect is, I'm going to draw my content from what I've been sharing, and perhaps we can look at how we can transfer that into what we're trying to do here. Now, the first thing that I do and what I work with my clients is helping them understand what they're looking for within someone. The common mistakes I see people fall into are going into something with not really a firm understanding of knowing what they want, right? They may have an idea of the superficial things, but they haven't really took a deep look at what they want from someone for the long term. So that's a very important exercise that I do. And you can look at it as almost like putting in the GPS coordinates before you head out onto the road, right? And I feel like a lot of us, we sometimes we drive around and we take a wrong turn and we end up in a dead end. So it's a really great thing to do for if you're starting out in dating. And I think it's a really important thing to think about when we are thinking about our family values. You know, what's important within our family unit? What are the things that we want to honor amongst us? And one thing is understanding and making yourself aware of what those things are. But the other is actually having the ability to communicate it, right? We attach a lot of fear or perhaps shame when it comes to communicating our wants, our needs, our desires. And I think that could be true within the family as well. So that's something we need to think about. Like we can be aware of all of the things that we want in our family, but how are we communicating to others? Why are we attaching shame to speaking up and having a voice in our family. I mean, this is a family. This should feel like a safe space, right? Which moves me on to talk about conflict, right? One of the reasons why we attach fear to communicating our values, wants, needs, and desires in our relationships, whether they are in our family or, you know, with our significant other, is because we attach shame and fear. But really, the real consequence of not communicating that is causing a big misunderstanding between people, right? If you think about it at work, if you assume that your colleague knows exactly what to do with a certain project without any sort of guidance, then it's very likely going to go wrong. So we have to take the same train of thought when it comes to sharing what's important to us. Otherwise, what happens, we get frustrated, we have expectations of the other, and those needs don't get fulfilled. So that might be a bit of homework for all of us today, actually. I think, like, maybe think about what is important to us. I normally do a list of, you know, the character traits I'm looking for with someone. But right here, I think we could be thinking about what are our boundaries, right? And how can we communicate our boundaries as well? Introduce a boundary there. I had a call coming through. Well, you threw me off guard there. Right, so we talked about a value system and the fear to perhaps creating conflict in the relationship or family. It's an interesting one, conflict, because admittedly, I'd be the first to hold my hand up and say, in the past, I haven't handled it well. You know, I've gone on vacations with my girlfriends at the time, and we've had an argument, and I've stormed out and spent the night on the balcony, right? Or I've stormed out of the house, and you know, in a strop, and you know, it's without any sort of empathy, you know, of what that other person is experiencing. It's quite a selfish way to handle conflict, you know, just walking out having a tantrum. So it brings me back to, you know, the journey I went on with myself when it came to this. I thought, well, how do I handle that better? And when we are having a dispute, when there is conflict at hand, I think it's important to, if you do need to take space, you need to go for a walk, just tell your partner, look, I understand what you're saying. It's a bit heated right now. I just need to take 5 minutes and I'll be back, right? And it's very important because you never really know about someone's history or the trauma they've been through. You might trigger abandonment issues. So I think that's just something that I've learned and I feel that could be helpful in terms of managing conflict in a family dynamic. Also as well, I think we have a tendency to get very defensive. So I think a rule should be, like, when you feel that someone, your partner or someone in your family is attacking you, it's, you know, that they mean well, right? They mean well. And everyone is trying to get better at doing this stuff. And, you know, we're not out to hurt people. You know, we have this unit of love and we're communicating this thing because we want better for each other, right? So it's to understand that. Give that person some time. Don't be defensive. Don't try and raise a point on top of their point. Wait till they've finished addressing their point and start it. I think this is very powerful with, thank you for sharing that. Like, that's really helped me understand such and such, as opposed to coming back with a right hook or a left hook, you know, like just take it. You know, it might be five. I always say, like, it's better to have 5 minutes of an uncomfortable talk rather than 6 months of, you know, discomfort with each other, because you're both too afraid to communicate something that's important to you. Okay, so those are my thoughts on conflict. Sharing, just being vulnerable there myself, just sharing you with you a little bit in regards to some of the things that I've experienced. You know, but if you can get that right, you know, I really feel that you're going to have a healthier dynamic within the family. It's something that we avoid. And I would tell you firsthand, my mother, for example, a couple of years ago, you know, she hasn't seen her father for 28 years, right? And I hadn't really met him, and probably when I was like three years old was the first time I met him, and probably the last, you know? And it was Mother's Day, we sat down, and her mother passed away when she was 30, right? And that's a different story. So my mom's had a lot of loss and in her life. And I'm sitting down and I go, oh, do you miss your mom? She goes, yeah, I do miss my mom. I never really got to spend too much time with her. And I said, what about your dad? And she said, well, he's never really been a dad for me. Yeah. And I go, well, you know, I said that I would go and see him. And she goes, yeah, you did say that. But I don't know how, because you don't know where he lives. And 5 minutes later, I text my auntie and she gave me the address for him. And I went over to see him. Then a couple of days later, I turned up on his doorstep and I went over to see him. And I just was so curious, because like especially the work that I do, you know, I'm working with people, relationships. I'm like, how has this gone wrong? Like, how have you not seen my mum for 20 years? Like, I needed answers. And what I come to realize was that this man has been suffering majority of his life with social anxiety. And you know, there's been conflicts and valid reasons why one would distance themselves from the other. But I think there's been a massive lack of understanding of social anxiety in our family. You know, my grandfather, I've never really called him that, he sat there and he's never seen her for 28 years. My mum hasn't seen him. They both have social anxiety, and it all stems from, you know, early on in life. So the big thing here is empathy. Yeah, you when you start to see things from someone else's side, you then start putting yourself in a position where you could potentially bridge some reconciliation. And I think that's a really important thing to note. We can get so hot at times and just want to stick to our point, but it really does pay to look from the other side and see how other people see it. And I think that's a very important value and understanding to have in your relationships with your family. Something that I also want to address is when you feel like you've got a nice setup, you know, you're with someone you love, life will challenge you. Life will test you. It really will. Especially if you live quite a social life, you know, you risk your union being compromised from the environments that you frequent. And again, I'll share a story of you. You know, I was catching up with a friend for after work drinks. And I was looking around and I was in a relationship at the time. And I was like, dude, you got to get me out of here. Like, there's a lot of like thirsty people in here. Like, you got to get me out of here. And he goes, oh, it's funny. He goes, you know, I've always been loyal to my partner. And I go, yeah, that's really honorable. And he goes, I always, when I find myself weak in moments and I feel that life is testing me, I ask myself, does this action compromise the relationship? You know, does this mess up the project? The project being the family, the relationship. And just that phrase was just so valuable to hear from him, because I think that we all encounter those moments, and we all have weak moments. I don't care how strong people say their relationships are, you get people that are very good at seduction and flirting and charming you. And so it's good to have a few sort of self-talk phrases up your sleeve for those moments. So that's just something else that I wanted to share, because remember, like, all right, this might be something that the ego wants right now. This might be something superficial that you're chasing right now, but ask yourself, does it mess up the project? The project being something more deeper and more meaningful, your family back at home. Maybe that's something we only need to consider when we're on those business trips. Okay, yeah, there was some other notes here that I just mentioned about the conflict thing, because I think it was a really important issue. It's to always just stay calm, yeah, and never resort to abuse, you know. And I think that's always a red flag. I mean, you've just got to audit yourself at times as well. Like, sometimes you do get hot, then you do get heated, but if you can set the frame of being very mature in this space, then you're gonna look after each other moving forward. There's a really great book. It's a very popular book. I'll be surprised if some of you haven't heard of it. But in the field that I work with, it's called The Five Love Languages, and it's by a guy called Gary Chapman. And you know, again, I'm thinking about the times where I've been frustrated with the other in my relationship, of them not understanding how I would like to receive love, because love can be received in many ways. You know, in the book, there's five of them, you know, one of them being quality time, the other being acts of service, the other being words of affirmation, and the other physical touch. So, you know, I've had times where I've been in my own relationships where it's hit me really hard where someone hasn't followed through with a plan that we had on the weekend, you know, or planning something nice, and the other in the relationship doesn't really, like, they're not really bothered about doing anything nice. And it's just because they don't understand what my love language is. So there's a great way, I think that it's worth a Google. Google the five love languages, and there's a quiz that you can take. And it's for partnership, it's for colleagues, it's for family. And I think it's a very valuable bit of information to attain, because when you understand what your love language is and your partners and those other people that you love, you then know how to make them feel special in the right way. It might be that, you know, that your past partner really loved receiving gifts, right? And that's just something you got accustomed to doing. That was their love language. But your next partner or someone else in your family really likes to be praised, you know, and that's just something that you're not doing a lot. And it maybe doesn't come natural to you. But I think if you're conscious of the different ways that the people that are important to you like to feel loved, then you're going to make them feel a bit better about themselves. So, yeah, I think that's all I got to share with you guys today. I hope it's been useful. I've had to put this together at the last minute because I didn't have much time to put it together, but it's been an honor. It's an honor. This is definitely a great time in my career to be sat doing this. So thank you very much for the privilege.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Johnny Cassell. It was very heartwarming, the speech, especially when you speaking about your own personal experience. Thank you for sharing that with us. And you're right about the project of family. And I think when people decide to be united, they need to discuss that project. They need to share these visions and their fears. And you're right about also the concept of fears. And I mean, in politics, we know that fear is a big element for conflict, and not accepting the other. So thank you very much for highlighting there and sharing, you know, very heartwarming stories of your life. And I'm sure our audience has really benefited from this heartwarming discussion. Thank you very much for being with us. And for short notice as well, thank you, merci beaucoup. Thank you. And we move on to our third author and researcher to advance and institutional law of marriage, sorry. Distinguished fellow, American Psychiatric Association, medical director at Fuller Hospital, and Dr. Holtzman's research focuses on seeing out data to better help understand relationship patterns of husbands and wives. He is a medical director of Northern Rhode Island Community Service and a clinical assistant professor of psychiatry and human behavior at Brown Medical School. He also has an active private practice with a focus on marriage counseling for individuals and couples. In 2007, Dr. Holtzman was honored by the Women's Resource Center of Newton and Bristol Counties in Rhode Island as one of the 19 men who made a difference. And I'm sure Dr. Holtzman will make a great difference today in our discussion today. And I just wanted to add that Dr. Holtzman, he has written many books on marriage, on the secrets of happy marriage for men and for women. And also today he will be sharing with us his thoughts and on the secrets of happy families. I'm very honored to have with us today Dr. Scott Holtzman. Thank you very much for being here. Thank you.
Thank you, Vivian. Thank you, Sonia, and everyone else involved in putting together this conference. We all have loved the idea of getting together on Zoom, and then most of us spend about 15 minutes trying to push the buttons and get it working right. So I just want to check in with folks. You can just give a thumbs up if everybody can hear and see me okay. Looking for thumbs ups. Vivian, everything okay over there?
I can hear you very well.
Oh, okay, great, thanks. You're the only person I can see, so I need your thumb up. I don't see everybody else. I've got to switch to gallery, I think. Okay, well, good morning in Rhode Island, and good hello from all over the country. Just some corrections so that people don't think I'm not misrepresenting myself. I'm now a assistant professor at Boston University rather than Brown University, and don't have a private practice in therapy anymore, although I still am very active in terms of doing couples education, and happy to talk about the difference if that comes up in questions. I was just going to talk briefly about a couple points. Because I think a lot of what we're hoping to do is dialogue. The first is this that Vivian had asked me to address is a question of happiness. All of my books, Secrets of Happily Married Men, Secrets of Happily Married Women, and The Secrets of Happy Families, which is the basis on today's discussion, have the word happiness in them. My most recent book, which is called Secrets of Surviving Infidelity, doesn't have that, although I guess I could say happily surviving infidelity. But at any rate, I just wanted to spend a minute talking about the concept of happiness. It is a subject which has been researched quite a bit within the past few decades. A lot of that's been prompted by the whole idea of a positive psychology. And a positive psychology is one in which people will work toward understanding the things that enrich their lives and focus on augmenting and boosting the positive aspects of their lives rather than focus on the negative. You know, an example might be going to a psychoanalyst and lying down and having that therapist encourage you to talk about all the pains and difficulties that you've had in your life, the traumas and the turmoils, and then work with that psychoanalyst for however many years it takes to kind of emerge at the other end. The flip side of that might be positive psychology, where you'll sit down with a therapist, not lie down on a couch. And the therapist will say, what are you good at? What are your strengths? What sports did you play in high school? You know, what are you passionate about? and then really steer towards someone toward the things that they're really good at, rather than focusing on all of the pain and destruction in their lives. And I think positive psychology plays a great role in the work that I do, because I want real people to really focus on what their strengths are. Relationships, for most people, initiating a relationship is something that, you know, they're really good at. They know how to, you know, strut their stuff at the attention of someone else. Not everybody is good at that. Johnny said he had a few years of difficulties, but it seems like he's gotten a bit better at it. But I think the idea of sustaining a relationship, figuring out what your strengths are and what you bring to a relationship, are what I think ultimately will keep a relationship moving forward, keep a relationship gaining strength, and make each individual in the relationship grow. So, so the whole concept of happiness is one in which researchers have, and I will condense all of the research to a few very simple concepts. Happiness researchers believe that there are three components to happiness. The first of those is something that I think all of us would expect related to happiness, which is something brings you pleasure and something brings you joy. So all of us can think of the things that make us laugh and smile and we enjoy doing. And so one would say, well, there you go. It brings me joy. This must be happiness. Nope, not quite. The second thing about that, the feature of happiness, this is most of the research is done by Martin Seligman, thought to be the father of positive psychology. But the second component is something called flow, which is to say that not only are we engaging in something we enjoy, but time just kind of disappears when you do it. You get absorbed in it and don't even realize that you've been investing hours in doing something that's pleasurable, because the flow is such that just time goes by. So that are two features of happiness. And again, this particular researcher, a theorist, kind of feels like there's a third component for true happiness. And the third component is meaning. So not only does something need to bring you joy, not only does it need to absorb you so that you don't pay attention to the passage of time, but also it has to have some particular meaning to you. I'll just give a brief example. If I enjoy playing video games, and I can spend hours playing a video game and don't even realize time has passed, arguably, and it would take a great debater to argue opposite of this, there's no meaning to playing a video game. So researchers would say that's not real happiness. And that may make you feel happy at the moment. But there's a third component, which I mentioned, and that has to be that there has to be some meaning to it. So I like to kind of put that in the background as I'm dealing with patients or dealing with clients or just dealing with myself and try to understand what am I looking for. And you can't always be happy. Not everything will bring you happy, but happiness. But if you're striving for that, it's important to know what you're looking for. And the other thing I want to touch on before we open up the discussion is I want to kind of put on my psychiatry hat, which is to say a medical doctor, and talk about what we understand as the biology of love and the biology of relationships. Because to me, it's just a fascinating look into what we believe is rational thought, being driven by our own knowledge of ourselves, our needs, and our wants. And you know, people working in labs will say, no, you're not as much control as you think you are. So we like to divide the concept of love into three components. The first would be that the immediate attraction that individuals have to each other. The second would be the infatuation phase, And the third would be the mature love phase. And one can argue whether or not these are legitimate, but the thought is that they have to do with your internal brain chemicals or hormones. So we believe, for example, that attractive love, that the initial attraction, really has more to do with estrogen and testosterone than it has to do with thought or emotion. So for example, when women are in their fertile phase, they're much more likely to find men attractive. Some great studies about even pheromones that women will find the smell of a man's sweat smoked shirt, for the most part, pretty disgusting. But in those few days, in her estrous cycle, when she's more likely to get pregnant, she actually may find it attractive. Men tend to run a pretty high level of testosterone all the time. In fact, men's level of testosterone is about 10 times higher than women's. And there is pretty clear evidence in the animal kingdom and even in humans that higher levels of testosterone, or even just biologically normal levels of testosterone, will drive a desire for men to have sex. So a lot of that first meeting could very well just have to do with not, is this my life partner? Is this someone who I want to spend the rest of my life with? But it may have more to do with the hormones that are surging through your body. Now, once you've made that initial connection, by the way, you may never have a second connection. You may end up in, you know, going to bed with that person and the next day waking up and saying, no, I you know, why was I with him or her? But the next connection, the next phase is what we call infatuation. And that can last for several months, even several years. And those are when your brain chemicals, for instance, dopamine, which most of us recognize as the reward hormone, and norepinephrine, which is very similar to epinephrine, which is also called adrenaline. Those chemicals are quite high in that second phase where you're infatuated with someone. So you're feeling alert, you're feeling excited, you're feeling rewarded for your interactions with that person. And the other brain chemical that many of us psychiatrists talk about and even prescribe medicines for is something called serotonin. Serotonin is thought to be associated with low serotonin states mentally or in your brain are thought to be associated with depression. Their low serotonin states are thought to be associated with obsessive compulsive disorder, even panic disorder. So a lot of people assume that if you're in that infatuation phase, not only do you have the norepinephrine and the adrenaline racing, not only do you have the dopamine peaked because it's a novel experience, but your serotonin is high also. But what's interesting is actually during the phases of infatuation, your serotonin levels are actually low, which explains why you have this obsessive need to be with that person. You're not really happier when you're infatuated. In fact, you kind of have this sense of discomfort and misery until you're with the person. You know, the minute you leave them, you start to worry, am I going to see him again or her again? You know, are they going to give me a phone call? Did I screw things up when I ordered the, when I ordered the shrimp instead of ordering the lobster? You start to have a lot of worries. So I think that the idea is your serotonin state actually is somewhat low, and it can only be raised up when you're with that person. So this really drives your need to be with that person, and it feels a lot like love, and it is a form of love, but it's not the mature love that we're expecting to see. And as we evolve past the first few years or first few months sometimes, that is where I think the love that most of us are aspiring for, and I think is, I would venture to say, the goal of today's meeting, at least if we're talking about romantic love. We're also talking about filial love. We're talking about other types of love as well, paternal love, platonic love. But in terms of romantic love, that's really what most of us are aspiring to. And that's really a point at which your serotonin levels start to come up to normal and your dopamine, your norepinephrine start to mellow out. And I think our first presenter did a wonderful job describing what it's like to kind of settle in. And you could, as she said, you could spend the next 25 years at that kind of low dopamine, low norepinephrine, normal serotonin state. But those of us in the field of marriage education don't recommend that people just coast. And that's why so much of keeping a marriage alive and keeping a relationship alive is injecting into it excitement, novel stimulus, interesting things, things that keep the levels of norepinephrine and dopamine elevated so that you're looking forward to seeing your spouse when you wake up in the morning and not cringing the idea of, you know, getting home at the end of the day from work because you need to see him or her. So there's a lot more that I would love to discuss, but I think what I'll do is leave it there as a teaser and kind of put it back to folks in terms of where we want to go with the discussion.
Thank you very much, Dr. Scott Holtzman. That was really amazing, and you've touched on the value of having meaning in a relationship. That was really very important. And also, very few of us know about the biological side of a relationship. Sometimes, you know, people might not be have the same passion or have the same involvement as other people. And this we are not aware, many people are not aware that some people are not, physically capable, like in sports, you're not able to perform, or the way your mindset works, it's not very engaging into that. So I think I don't know if you agree with me, but this also requires not only, I don't know if you resort to medication, but does it require training, like when you join a gym and you train? Does it require mental and training? This question was, maybe we can leave it till the end when everybody's answering questions, but I was very, positive psychology was very important, you know, focusing on a couple's strength and making sure that every member of the family grows. I agree with you on that. This is very core, because I think you should feel that when your partner grows, you are growing. And when your family members, I mean, putting their interests and yours as one, I see that as something that really works. And thank you for being with us. I know it's very early in Boston, and you've made an effort just to be here with us. You're amazing. Thank you, sir.
Thank you for the positive feedback. As Johnny would say, those are words of affirmation, and greatly appreciated. And just a brief answer to your question is, yes, I think people can be educated. People can learn how to be good at relationships. And one of the biggest failings, at least in Western society, is the idea that I should just go on my emotions. That will carry me through relationships. And I do believe that, non-Western societies have a much more practical notion that, you know, it's not just going to, love is not going to carry you through the next 70 years. Certainly lust won't carry you through, but people can be trained. People can be educated on how to make relationships, particularly marriages in my case, work.
Scott Holtzman for answering my question. And we move on to our next speaker, Mr. Josiah Howley. Now here's something very interesting. Mr. Howley is a musician and a songwriter He made a splash on TV as a top 10 finalist for The Voice. Josiah comes from a family of musicians, and his father was also a musician in Arkansas. His new EP includes the singles I Just Want You Love, You're the One, and others. Josiah recorded and produced songs in LA and in Tokyo. And I had a chance to talk with Josiah. What a beautiful name, Josiah, I have to say. I had the pleasure of talking to him, and he's not only just a musician. Josiah is someone who's has very strong depth and understanding love, and he has a vision on and a philosophy of that love. And I think he will be also sharing with us some surprise song as well. The floor is yours, Josiah. Welcome.
Thank you so much. Yeah. You guys can see the audience. Everybody here, but I can see them. A little bit of a delay when I talk and goes through the speaker. We might have to mute it just when I sing, just so otherwise it's not weird. I'm not sure.
Without the speaker, you prefer without the speaker.
Only if it picks up. Maybe it didn't pick it up. Maybe it's good now. Feels good. So much. For having me, and I got to speak with Vivian on Wednesday. I think it was Wednesday. Yeah, that's yesterday. That was yesterday. it was yesterday. It was very engaging. I liked you from the second I heard your voice. It was just so fun to talk to you, and you were just like super encouraging. And so I'm just going to share just a quick song with you. It's just on my road. It's actually called Tokyo. It was just about moving from Tokyo to LA before coming here. And when you move to a new place and you don't have a work visa set up yet, it's a little difficult, you know. And then when you finally get a work visa and you're an entertainer, I have an entertainer visa. They only approved me for 3 months, for 90 days, because, you know, we'll see if he's going to actually make money or if he'll make it here, that kind of things, but I assume. So it was, you know, difficult then to find a place to live because no one's going to rent to you when you have a 90-day visa. And so jumping around from Airbnb to Airbnb and until I can get a longer visa, which was then only 6 months. And anyway, it was just a process in being here. But I've been here 4.5 years, and it's just been an incredible journey. So that's it. The song's called Tokyo. Here we go.
There's a place we come to, it's far away, and we know nobody, nothing feels the same, yet we've got each other, and that's okay. Can't imagine if you weren't here. We took all our things and gave away, only brought with us enough to feel safe. Yet we've got each other, and that's okay. Will we ever feel at home again? No other place I'd rather be. Holding you, you holding me. Nobody asking for me, see where we are going. I invite you for me. Even when things get so crazy, let's just take a moment, breathe it in. Oh, oh, oh. So we started moving from place to place. Couldn't stay too long. Someone please have grace. Yes, I know we're strangers from far away. We just wanna find a roof to call our own. There's an energy here, it moves to and fro. It can feel quite scary, it makes us, you know. Come to realize we're not here alone, but it matters that we're here, yes. Oh, no other place I'd rather be. Holding you, you holding me. Nobody else can fully see where we are going. I invite you for me. Even when things get so crazy, let's just take a moment, breathe it in. I'm not exactly sure the future holds. I don't know what tomorrow will look like. Still, I shore of the rest of the day. But as long as you are with me, I will be home. As long as you are with me, we can make a home. No other.
The next one is just a cover song. You actually probably know it. If you want to sing, oh my gosh, that would be great. Just jump on in. It's from the...
Then you have to unmute
it. Yeah, well, that would be chaos. But I actually love the song. I think it fits right in with the theme. And the artist was really cool as well. But you'll see. It's about having hope and about having faith to invest in the person that will give it back to in the real thing, basically, right? Anyway.
Well, I guess it would be nice if I could touch your body. I know not everybody's got a body like you, but I gotta think twice before I give my heart away.
I'm going to use my phone here, so forgive me.
Okay.
Oh, here we go.
I think I'm just going to pull this down now that I'm done playing. Love, it's such a risky thing, isn't it? Because it takes us out of our comfort zone. I'm just going to look around. I like doing that better. I'll just do both. It can take us out of our comfort zone sometimes. And so it's a risk, you know, we're not sure if it's going to be reciprocated. And if it is, it's like extremely rewarding, of course. But if it's not reciprocated, it's like, depending on the level of risk, right? It could be sad, it could be depressing, it could be wounding, you know, it can really wound us. Yet to love someone requires like putting yourself out there. And so I think it's more than just like a physical experience. It's more than just sex. But at the same time, I think the best type of love actually needs to be experienced. I think it is experiential love. And that kind of love requires action, right? It takes thought. But we have to be able to receive love. And so for me, I think to be in a position where we can receive love is everything, you know. I don't think we can actually give what we don't have, right? So if we need to learn how to be able to receive love fully, to give love fully. So I think that's the special thing, right? So movies tell us certain things about love. Our parents teach us about love, good or bad, and our teachers do, and our friends do. And the problem is sometimes we may not, their version of love, of what they've taught us, might not actually hit us the way we need, you know. And so it's interesting that they mentioned the five love languages. Johnny mentioned that, right? I love that reference, great reference, because it's all about how we receive love. And so the thing that's difficult is that sometimes our parents and our teachers and our friends, they don't actually, maybe they haven't taken the time to really see us in that moment or to really understand what we need in that moment. And so they're just going off of what they think or just their habits of whatever. And so they're not able to reach us in the way that we really need to be reached. And that's what the most important thing is. And so I think to be able to receive love well is extremely important. And so I'm just going to use a quick reference of, I'm not a fan of religion. For the most part, forgive me if anybody is, I'm just not a big fan of religion, but I actually am a fan of Jesus. Done some studying. I'm reading a book on it right now called The Genius of Jesus by Erwin Raphael McManus. Super interesting book. Just talks about just how Jesus lived and him being a genius. It's really cool. So I'm fascinated by the things of Jesus. So there's one question that Jesus was asked. It was like, almost as like a trick. They're like, what's the most important thing? What's the most important commandment? And he goes, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. And the second is equally important. And I'm like, okay. And he says, love others as you love yourself. And so when I've read that, it just struck me so heavily, like, huh. So if I'm going to love others, I have to love myself. It's almost like first, you know? And to love yourself, you need to understand you need to understand who you are, and you need to understand what you need, like yourself. And it requires being present, right? It requires being aware of yourself and aware of what you need. So let's just say like in the pandemic that it's been the last couple of years, it's been quite difficult for many people, especially like mentally, right? Just with everything that's been going on. And so I think it's important to know, like, what do I need right now? You know, I just need to get out and get some fresh air. Okay, great. So it's good to know that, but to be aware of it, right? And so go on a walk, you know, or I need to be by the water. Great, go to the ocean. And, you know, so it's just important to be aware of yourself and what you need. That being said, I think that also is the most important way to see the person next to you, to love the person next to you. Is like you have to see them, you know, you have to be aware of them and to know what they need. I think that actually is difficult because you have to be present, you know, and it's hard to be present all the time, especially if you're going through your own stuff. But I think that's the important thing, is to be present so you can understand what you need, so then to be present to understand what the person next to you needs. And I think that actually
is what makes family, can be what makes the family the most successful, right? It's when we're present with ourselves and what we need and what our spouse needs and then what our kids need. It's just about constantly being present. And then when you are present, I think it was, I can't remember who said it, but they said it's like when the parents are the most present and the romance is alive, like it just filters down. And it's just a beautiful thing. So you just get to see this like beautiful picture. I think it was Ufried who said it, this beautiful like pyramid, the top of the pyramid, when the parents have it right, because they've loved themselves well, they've loved each other well, it just filters right down to the kids and it filters into society, because all of a sudden we have all these other people who get to see what it looks like to be loved well and to love well. And so that's just a beautiful picture. And so of course, I think we should all aspire to do that. I know I want to do that. You know, I want to be in a very successful relationship that's doing really great, you know? Lastly, I think the first point of what Jesus says, to love the Lord your God, I think it's, what does that even mean? Like for me, when I read that, I'm like, I don't know what that means. I don't know how to do that. I don't like how, you know, whether it's you say the universe or whether you say creator, whether you say love, how do you love something if, you know, if you can't see it? I don't even know exactly what that means. However, I find it fascinating that he says this next thing's equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself, love the other person as you love yourself. I think it's very fascinating because I think that actually is how you show fruit and how you show that you actually are aware that there is a creator, you're aware that there is something bigger than you. It's like the fruit is in the love of how you take care of yourself and how you take care of others and how you see others. And that for me is like, that's everything. So I think that's actually what Jesus is talking about being the best human that we can be. Because we as humans have been created with this incredible capacity to love. And when we're wounded, we're created with the capacity to forgive. And I think that's like one of the most incredible, amazing things in a relationship that has been gifted to us, is that we can forgive others. And then after we've forgiven them, we can move forward, you know? And so that I think is incredible. So I actually don't really have much else to say other than saying I feel very honored to be a part of this and to be able to hang out with all of you guys. There's so many things that everybody said. Ufried said, she talked about there's no romance with no love, which I thought was really cool. But then she said also showing the other person how much you value them. And I thought that was just so incredible. That's just such a beautiful thing, like that someone can do, is to show them, I'm going to show you how valuable you are to me by giving you a gift or by just talking to you for a long period of time or giving you a call, good, you know, taking you to the beach or whatever. I love that. And I love what Johnny was saying about the difficulties, but yet the strength in communicating well our desires and our fears and our wants, and like communicating that with our partners. I think that is so valuable. I think communication a lot of times gets forgotten, or just gets, we forget that how important it is to communicate well. So I appreciate Johnny saying that. I thought that was incredible. And I like what Scott said about focusing on what your strengths are. I think that's sometimes in the West, where I grew up in America, it's almost like you're told like, these are your strengths, but you need to be well-rounded. So you need to focus on these things that you're weak at so you can be a whole human being and be, you know, really rounded. But not that that's bad. However, I think it's beautiful talking about like focusing on your strengths, because if you're really good at something naturally, like why not continue to hone that skill and to push into that? So I really like what everybody's been saying. I'm very encouraged to be a part of this. So thank you guys. I've taken a lot of notes. Thanks for having me. I'm done.
Thank you very much, Josiah, for, I don't know, for immersing us into this, you know, world of music and world of thought. And I think you complete the circle, you know, that we've been going around speaking from different perspectives, whether it's physical, romantic, or psychological, and then all the love that we have discussed earlier, the different natures of love, the different types of love we covered, and then you come with that little completing summary of it. Thank you very much for being here, and thank you for the lovely music. But we move on to conclude, we'd like to open the floor for everyone, for all the participants online, if they would like to ask questions to the panelists with us today. Thank you all.
I had a question, if I may. I had a question for the audience.
Yes, I'd like them to either
share their concept of romance or to share a story, a brief story of a romantic moment, if they wish.
Okay, I'm going to start nominating.
Yes, Sonia, go, Sonia.
I'm wrong with you.
Yes, please.
Yes.
Oh, no. You saw my smile.
Yes. Yes.
All right, I kind of laughed. This is a microphone here?
Yeah.
I'll speak to the microphone. Okay. Nice to be with everyone tonight. Thank you for allowing me. This is my second meeting, and I'm enjoying this very much. I have a lot of questions myself. I think we're all a little reluctant because there's so much content here, but... Hey, I'll start just quickly. I laugh a little bit because my wife, I've been married for about 27 years. We're happily married, but I was infatuated with my wife. She had no interest in me for the first little while. She's a very spiritual person, and she had a feeling that I was not good for her. And honestly, she was right, because I was fresh off of another relationship that didn't go well. Mm. And I was hurting at the time. And I wasn't really ready to be in another relationship, but I was quite intrigued by her. So I approached her several times in our little social group. We met at church, actually. I don't like church, but I'm a church guy. But we met at church several times. But she was not interested. She had this feeling that she should stay away from me. And she's actually a champion ballroom dancer. And we had a Valentine's dance one time. She had been out on the dance floor dancing with some guys who could do a little bit of ballroom. I've taken a few classes. I'm not great, but I could do, like, sort of hold my own. But on the dance floor, I asked her to dance. Well, before... earlier in the evening, I had asked her to dance, and she grabbed the guy next to her and said, no, he's going to dance with me, so no. And I thought, well, that was kind of odd. Anyway, I asked her at the very last dance. There was no one else around. She was all alone. I walked up and said, would you dance with me? She sort of looks around like this and said, well, okay. So we went onto the dance floor. She tolerated me for the dance. And I didn't try to do anything fancy, but I let her do her thing. She's really an amazing dancer. Anyway, at the end of the dance, I tried to talk to her a few times, no feedback, nothing. She wouldn't talk to me at all. Mm. At the end of the dance, as we walked out the dance floor, I said, well, how did I do? My dancing, I mean. And in Japanese, she said, well, what do you say to Naikido? Which means, well, you don't have any bad habits. And she walked off. Mm. And I thought, you know, I've done about everything I can to try to say, I don't know what else to do. I better leave her alone. And the next day I saw her at church, and she invited me for dinner. And we ended up talking for 3 hours. Mm. And the rest is history. And it was just fascinating. I asked her later on, I said, why did that happen? She said, on the dance floor, I got the feeling that I could get to know you now. It's your time. You've healed. Mm. And it's time for me to get to know you. And we were engaged within about 2 months.
Wow, beautiful.
So it was kind of a fascinating miracle in my life.
Yeah.
That we connected. Yeah.
So that's beautiful. Thank you.
Oh, please, you can write your next novel.
Absolutely. I'll have to visit Japan so that I can be authentic about the setting.
Yes, any day would be. Do I have to pick everyone?
Any other questions from the audience? Please raise your hand. Or maybe any comment, or maybe you would like to share your thoughts.
Professor Linga, you have many things to hear when you were talking. Now you can say that.
Hello, Milanga. My name is Milanga. I was interested in seeing how research can progress in the relationship. So I wanted to Are we talking, the topic is about family or what comes before family, marriage and love? Or do we accept that the three are interconnected?
Three are interconnected.
Ah, okay, we, all of us accept that. So I just want to say that the, to the professor, Sonia here, are we starting to rationalize the different parameters that make love in what we are starting to do now? Are we trying to rationalize this thing called love, marriage? We are on this earth since 46 billion years. I don't know exactly if the professor can tell us when did men realize the necessity of being together to make a family in the chronology of time. 1 million years ago, 100 years ago, and today, the, you have seen in the last last salon how my intervention was focusing on the evolution of the stability of marriage. I just say that, okay? People mention the Western world. In fact, Western world means money, isn't it? That defined the Western world today compared to the. Okay, so my question last time was to know why, before everybody, be it in America, in Europe, or in Japan, became rich, we had some data on marriage. And then after that, now where, when we have money in everything, the rate of marriage is decreasing. Mm. This is a very difficult subject. Then my question again is, can we rationalize all the parameters that make that thing we call love? That is my question.
Do you want to rationalize it, or?
Because is it possible to rationalize or not? Is that your question?
Is it possible to rationalize or not? Sonia mentioned once, mentioning a topic, if we can have an influence on the society. It means if we can go, if we can start the publishing and go to the academic, because the young people are those who can, we can influence in order for them to make another society. You see, I'm not from the Western world, but I realized that, yes, the in the Western world, the fear of divorce has disappeared. Because with money, people can buy everything. People can buy love, can buy relationship. And the other, the part of, you know, we live in a society where we have a lot of hypocrisies. There are many things we don't admit, but the animal man that we are has got a part where you feel that it is to be great to have many partners. Man, there is that part in the human being. We should admit that. When we are student in a college, the one who is very successful to girls is admired by the other people. This is part of the human being. And we know which kind of havoc has been brought to the human being relationship by money. That's my contention.
I think, thank you very much, sir. I think Dr. Darina would like to ask a question to Dr. Scott Holtzman.
Hello, Dr. Holtzman, I wanted just to ask you about your opinion. If you can give us one advice or message that you can give, in fact, to a couple or two lovers who want to get married and form a family, what could be one single most important advice you can give?
Thank you very much, Dr. Darina. Thank you.
There you go. Okay, now I was gonna fake that I wasn't unmuted, and I'll just say something, and you'd all think it was brilliant. But I now am unmuted, so I actually have to try to say something that's brilliant. Actually, I do have an answer to that question, and it is something that's already been brought up, at least with regards to the love languages, which is. And I'll just encapsulate it in the following, and I give this specific recommendation. Basically, the first thing is to understand what it is that your partner wants or needs. Second, do it. And the third is don't do things that your partner that annoys your partner. And, you know, and I say this because we are, you know, even the idea do unto others as, what is the expression? Do unto others.
As you would have them do unto you.
Right. Right. Exactly. And that is, to me, that is not the secret of marriage. The secret of a happy marriage is do unto others as they would want to be done upon. You see, because we're assuming that you're going to do something, what you would want for yourself, but maybe what you want for yourself is nothing what your partner wants for him or herself. So what you need to do is figure out what your partner needs for himself or herself. Do more of that and do less of the things that your partner does not want you to do. And I do believe that once, you know, that, and that's where we can talk about the love languages, or we can talk about figuring out what your partner needs. But to me, that's the key. It's a selflessness and it's an intentionality about it. Somebody else had mentioned, and I can't remember who, about the idea of thinking about whether what you were going to do, I think it was Johnny that said this, is going to enrich the relationship. So there's an intentionality about everything you do, when it has to do, it's based on that core principle.
Thank you very much, Dr. Holtzman. Thank you. I have a question for Dr. Yubrit. Are you with us? Oh, well, there's someone. Ah, Julia Pukitaza has a question. Please go ahead first. Go ahead.
Hi. Thank you so much, everyone who contributed. A lot of content, and think really incredible to be a part of this. I have a question to all the panel speakers, just about attachment and love. I think from just to be a little bit vulnerable recently, I was with a partner and we're deeply involved and attached and in love, but because of religion, his family was unable to kind of approve the situation, and we both pragmatically had to speak and let each other go. And I think my question is, you know, I think unconditional love is also saying goodbye in certain situations, and I would love to really understand what comes after that. And I feel like in movies, there's a lot of like attachment being portrayed as love. But I think in my experience, like this is the hardest thing I've ever done. And I would just love to speak to someone who's in this field professionally, just to get a peace of mind. I think a lot of books and things like that has helped, but it would be wonderful to hear from someone.
Experience, and I hope one of our specialists, Dr. Scott, could you answer her question, please?
No, there's a tremendous amount of pathos, and you know we've been talking a lot about theory, but just in 2 minutes. When that person was describing their experience, I think all of us saw what it means to experience the intensity of love. There is that intellectual component, the emotional component, and a deep-rooted spirituality to the whole thing. And boom, it comes out in a couple minutes. So I really honor you for bringing that up. I know it's not easy, and. I do think that you bring up a good issue about attachment, which we really haven't talked a lot about. Now, again, from a medical point of view, we see attachment as being totally physiologic. When you are with somebody, particularly women have a higher level of oxytocin, which is known as the bonding hormone, which can make people feel really close. And ironically, men have lower levels of oxytocin, but when they experience orgasm, they actually have a burst of oxytocin, which is why they end up feeling bonded to the person they just had sex with. So there's a lot of physiology behind that. And I don't think that's what your question was, but I decided I'd show off a little bit and talk about brain chemicals. But now I will shift to what your experience is. And I think that we're probably in the midst of deep emotional experiences, we are of the belief that we're only going to get an opportunity like this once, and that we've come across our soulmate. That actually is one of the biggest complications I have in dealing with infidelity, is somebody will find someone else that they believe meets all their needs, and it can disrupt a marriage. But I think what I want to say is there is a great capacity for love. Infinite sounds a little bit too highfalutin, but I would say there's a great capacity for love. And it's wonderful to have the opportunity to feel the bonding, to feel the experience, and to have been there, to have been part of that journey into this place, which you hadn't been at before. No one's going to take away the sadness or the loss because it was very real. And it's part of your personal growth. And, you know, on a more practical level, it really sucks that something like, religion, which is supposed to, bring humans together, or parents, which are supposed to kind of care for their children enough that they're going to provide, that they want their happiness. It kind of sucks that those types of things have gotten in the way. But the flip side is, it's those practical matters. It's not the feeling of bonding. It's not the feeling of an intense emotional connection that carries through you through the next 30, 40, 50 years. It often does end up being those practical matters. And interestingly, studies show that a high percentage of conflict issues never end up getting resolved in successful marriages. But if it's that much of an obstacle that you can't proceed to that point, then then there's no words that are going to comfort you except to let you know that this is your journey.
No, thank you so much. No, that was really, really useful. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Now that I've started my day with saying something useful, I can quit for the rest of the day because that's about it. I get one shot at saying something useful per day.
You're totally off the hook. You're good.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other question from the audience? Anyone? Okay, I'm left with one question for Dr. Yupreet. Are you there, Dr. Yupreet?
I'm there.
Hello. Thank you. My question is about the impact of culture on our understanding of law. And I know you come from, we all come from different cultures. And I find even when we talked about the biological, I think that part was slightly missing in our discussion today, because I believe our culture impacts our upbringing and how we raise our children and families on love and what love is. So people think of love differently because they come from different cultural backgrounds. In some societies, they regard love as a crime or sex as something that is not acceptable, whereas some other cultures, they encourage that. What is your perception on that, Dr. Yupreet? Thank you.
Well, in my country, I can't say what happens in all over the country because I don't really know, but sex is taboo here. It's not something you talk about, and it's all closed doors. And I know that it's also a duty, because I know of this person who shared with me that even though there were a number of children and they no longer slept in the same room, she had to go every night and do her duty, and then that was fine. Then after that, she was free to do whatever she wanted to do. So there are all sorts of things, but sex for pleasure is taboo. You don't mention it in some of our. And dating, as I told you, is you'd have to be a very liberal family to encourage dating, or you'd have to be far from your children so you wouldn't know what's going on. And otherwise, everyone's a bit conservative. Actually, I think the reason is the patriarchy and how women still have to be young and pure. Otherwise, they won't get a decent spouse. So that makes in many cultures, in many of our communities, it's not something that you want to be talking about. And so that leads to a lot of misinformation, isn't that right? And lots of experimentation. You can't just put the toe on it. You have to do it.
Yes, that's right. I think that cultures do have an impact on how much we can love and how much love we can reflect in our lives. And I mean, I've been around, and I went into my schooling in Dubai when I was very young in the 90s, and then I moved to London and studied there. And for me, there was a big change moving from the front culture to the other, and then I moved back to my native country, which is Lebanon. And even within my country, which is very different when it comes to we have different cultures, different ethnic groups, and each group, each community has their own understanding of love. And that's what I think. This is something that maybe later on Sonia and the Bill Foundation would also consider about love and cultures. That would be maybe something that she probably would be, she could put that on her agenda. Thank you very much, Dr. Yupreet. Thank you.
I have another tiny little point.
Yes, please.
About when you're walking in public. I mean, I'm 60 years old, but if I hold my husband's hand, He's very uncomfortable because he's worried that we'll be heckled and followed home perhaps by the hecklers. But on the other hand, you read these embassy advisories for people traveling to India where they say if you see boys holding hands and walking on the road, it's just a thing that Indians do, and it doesn't mean they are gay or that, you know, if you are interested in that, you should approach them because boys can hold hands and they're just friends, but a husband and a wife, better not. That's just sad.
That's very interesting. Thank you for mentioning this. This is really awkward. Oh, anyway, thank you. That's a thought. Any other questions from the participants, from those with us online? Anybody would like to a question or add any remark before we close? Anyone there? Okay. Then I would like to conclude. Is that right? Yeah. Okay. I thought very hard on what I would like to, how I would like to conclude this session, and I thought of something that the famous French philosopher René Descartes said. He said, "I think, therefore I am." He was talking about his existence. About understanding about what human beings are. He said, I think, therefore I am. But later on, today's philosophers, they came up with a different model that gets at the core of what our being as humans. It is not so much that we are thinking beings, but that we are loving beings. We are created to love. Because our passions are at the core of who we are. So to be human is to love. I love, therefore I am. But this is the new motto, I love, therefore I am. And whether we have discussed today or our amazing panelists, we looked around and we studied romantic love. We discussed that beautifully. We talked about sexual love. We talked about divine love. We talked about self-love. We covered love from different psychological perspectives and from a relationship perspective. We looked at love from all angles. But what I think would be a right conclusion is that this love, the combination of all the love, is part of what family love is all about, the ethical love of a family. It is a combination. Yes, we have to love romantically. Yes, we have to love the universe. We have to love God. We have to love all nature. We have to love who we really are. And we have to love each other. And when we combine all this, what family is about, it symbolizes all of this love. So if the romance is lacking, then we have to try to work on that. If our love to others, or our love to God or to the universe. So all these loves combined together is the love of the family. And I'm very grateful. I would like to thank Mrs. Sonia so much for giving me this opportunity to be on one of the best and with one of the best panelists. I really very much enjoyed our discussion today. I'm very thankful to Mrs. Sonia and to Dylan Marty Foundation. I'm also thankful to my dear friend, Dr. Darima Saliba, and her team for being helpful today and supporting me on this beautiful, beautiful dialogue today. I want to thank also Dr. Yupreet Dhaliwal, Dr. Scott Holtzman, Dr. Johnny, Mr. Johnny Casal, Mr. Josiah Howley, and thank all the team here as well, Vanessa, Ren, Badia, and the interns as well for making this work. And I want to thank the audience, everyone participated today and was with us. Thank you all for being with us. And yes, I love, therefore I am. And I wish also Julia, who was not happy with us today, that that she found something helpful today from our discussion. And everyone who has questions on who they are and what love is, I hope we've managed to cover all that. I will leave the floor to dear Mrs. Sonia to have a closure. Thank you very much. Thank you all.
Again, thank you to everyone for taking active part in this discussion so we can make each of our discussions richer. And please do stay engaged with us as we will try to take this discussion into making some research reports. As Dr. Scott's Haltzman said, we can, if we can educate people better, we can probably help people understand what happiness really means and how people can have fulfilling lives. And to all the rest of the panel, Upi, from my childhood friend, thank you for being part of this. And it's a real honor to have you in our panel. And to John, Johnny, thank you for saying yes to being part of this. And I hope all of you and decide that you will take the time, Vivian, to help us create a thorough report that we can use to build our argument on what ethical family needs to be for the protection of human rights of its members. So a platform like UNESCO can help us disseminate this education to all over the world. And so our next panel next month will talk about women, place of women, as it's a Women's Day on March 8th, UN Women's Day. So I'm hoping that all of you will join us on March 17th, and hopefully you will also let many of your friends know about our discussions. Thank you so very much for giving us the time. Till next time.
Next time. Yes.
And please connect us on social media so we can meet you and we can hear from you on a regular basis.
Okay.
She was in Beirut or where?